Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to session two of today's Council on Foreign Relations Symposium on Risk and Strategy for the Changing World. I'm John Nagl, the ninth headmaster of the Haverford School in Pennsylvania and a retired Army officer. Our discussion will focus on risk in military planning, and I'm really going to ask the panel, who are all experts in military planning, military hardware, force structure, although they all could talk about geopolitics, we've had a bunch of geopolitics, we're going to have more. This is the one panel that I think can really focus on military capabilities to try to mitigate risk when planning fails, accomplish state objectives. I've got three friends on the panel, and I'm delighted to introduce them. First is Max Boot. Max is the Jeane Kirkpatrick Senior Fellow in National Security Studies here at the Council in New York. His most recent wonderful book is Invisible Armies, An Epic History of Guerrilla Warfare from Ancient Times to the Present. Janine Davidson is Senior Fellow for Defense Policy at the Council in Washington. From 2009 to 2012, she served in the Obama administration as the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Plans, where she oversaw the development of guidance for military campaign and contingency plans. So we're going to try to get her to talk about as much of that as we can, given that we're in an unclassified format. And finally, Theo Farrell is the Professor of War in the Modern World and head of the Department of War Studies at King's College London. He's been an advisor to Her Majesty's government on the war in Afghanistan and is writing a history of Britain's commitment to that war. I'd ask you to please completely turn off, not just put on vibrate, your cell phones, Blackberries, and other electronic devices. This is going to be such a fascinating panel. So hard-hitting, so insightful, you're not going to want to miss a second by looking at your machine. And finally, I'd like to remind the members that the meeting is on the record. We are being filmed. Anything you say may be used against you in a court of law. And I'm going to ask the panel to start by, I'm hoping to draw out some differences of opinion, I hope, between Max and Janine on this point. At the end of more than a decade of war, military forces are drawing down on both sides of the Atlantic, even at a time when it appears that geopolitical risk is increasing. I would ask all three of the panelists to discuss the military drawdown as they see it happening and what risks they believe our respective countries, the alliance, the Western world is incurring as a result of the drawdown in progress. Max.
Well, thanks very much, John, and I have to say it's an honor to appear before so many distinguished council members and friends, and I'm a little bit intimidated, frankly, to be sitting up here with somebody who's actually a headmaster of a school, because I'm very worried that if I say the wrong thing, John will cane me, so I quiver with fear here.
You should be so lucky, Max.
I know that you have people at these schools have these tendencies, but, you know, I don't.
We all have a role to play.
All right, enough of that. Back on to safer ground here. The risk that we are taking, I think, with our defense drawdown is unacceptable. And to me, it was really highlighted by what happened last month. On February 24th, Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel appeared in the Pentagon briefing room to announce the new defense budget for fiscal year 2015, which, among other things, is going to project a decline in Army and strength, the active duty Army forces that we have, from about 520,000 today to probably, I would guess, probably 420,000 within a decade, assuming that sequestration, this massive budget cut, which is going to occur over the course of the next decade, is not repealed. That is a pretty drastic cut in Army and strength, especially from the wartime high that we reached of 570,000, which I would argue was itself probably not sufficient to face all the challenges that we have. And it wasn't just, you know, a question of cutting the Army. The Marine Corps is getting cut. The Navy is probably going to be reduced effectively to 10 carriers. The Air Force is going to lose strength. All across the board, we are losing military strength. The share of GDP devoted to defense is going to go down to 3.4% next year, and within a decade it'll be down to 2.3%, which is a level we have not seen since 1940, i.e. the pre-World War II era. Now, all of this was, I believe, was premised on the assumption that the tide of war is receding, as President Obama, Chuck Hagel's boss, often likes to say. But is that, in fact, an accurate assessment of the world as we know it? Well, as it happens, and this is pretty rare, that the logic of a major policy blueprint released in Washington was refuted within two days, by real-world events. Because what happened 2 days after the fiscal year 15 budget was released? These mysterious self-defense forces, armed men without insignia, began taking over the Crimea. Within the course of the last month, Putin has annexed Crimea, the kind of cross-border aggression which we thought had been banished with the end of World War II in 1945, has suddenly reared its ugly head in Europe. And who can be confident that Putin, having gotten away with the annexation of Crimea, which is wildly popular in Russia, having gotten away with this, who can be confident that he will stop there? Who can be confident that he will not decide to swallow eastern Ukraine next? Or what about the Baltic republics? What would we do if Putin were to move on these NATO allies? We're going to be down to, if we're lucky, two brigade combat teams left in Europe. Our allies are cutting their defense budgets even faster than we are. Is this a prudent risk to take in a world in which Russia is suddenly an aggressor on the march? Is this a prudent risk to take in a world in which Iran is getting close to acquiring nuclear weapons? Is this a prudent risk to take in a world in which China just announced that it's increasing its defense budget by 12% next year, and in a world in which the Chinese Navy is acting in increasingly aggressive fashion against its neighboring states to try to assert dubious territorial claims over various islands, raising a situation dangerous enough, creating a situation dangerous enough that the president of the Philippines recently compared the situation to the 1930s, and in which the prime minister of Japan has openly spoken about the prospect of war between China and Japan. This, to me, is not a world in which the tide of war is receding. It is a world in which dangers abound and in which we disarm at our peril. Now, the argument, of course, is made that we still will have the largest military and the most capable military force in the world, that we will spend more than the next 10 or 12 military powers combined, and all of that is true. But I think it misses the point, because we also have greater security responsibilities than the next 10 or 12 powers combined. When you think about the adversaries and challengers that we face out there, most of them, in fact, pretty much all of them, are focused regionally. Russia is not trying to project force to Latin America. They're trying to dominate their near abroad. China is trying to dominate its near abroad, the Western Pacific. Iran is trying to dominate its near abroad, the Middle East. All of these powers have the advantage of focusing on their local terrain. We have the disadvantage, the obligation, and the duty of being concerned about the entire world. Because if we need to keep the peace in East Asia, we need to keep the peace in the Middle East, we need to keep the peace in Europe. These are the historic responsibilities we have taken on since 1945, and I think that we would put down this burden of global defense at our own peril, because I think we are the greatest beneficiaries of the free international trade system, of the progress of liberal democracy, of economic freedom, which has happened in the last 60 years and which has been underwritten by the security provided by American arms. The cost of continuing to provide this global protection to ourselves and to our allies is not that much. Again, we're talking about defense spending, which is a little bit over 4% today, declining to 3.4% of GDP next year, and ultimately down to 2.3% of GDP, which I think is too low. But during the 40-plus years of the Cold War, we kept defense spending at a rough annual average of around 8%. So there is nothing unaffordable about defense spending of 4%, which is roughly where we are today. I think what's unaffordable is not to spend that much and to risk the entire global collective security infrastructure, which we have struggled so hard to maintain ever since 1945. But I fear that is, in fact, where we are going. If the budget-cutting impetus behind the defense program is not reversed.
Janine, Max is obviously pretty concerned about the risk we're taking. You may have picked that up. My hope is that you're going to make us feel better.
Well, I'll start by saying I agree that the world is a dangerous place, but in order to understand what kind of military we need for that, we have to kind of understand what we mean when we say risk and what we mean when we say strategy. When I was in the Pentagon, you know, I had a hard time getting my head around what the military guys were saying when they said risk. We had, for instance, this one, my job was to review and all the war plans, and so we would get the generals and admirals in the room and they would start talking about what they were going to do if this or that happened. And I remember this one time early on when I kept saying, but you're making a lot of assumptions here about the kinds of forces you're going to be able to access. You know, I mean, maybe they're going to be, in this particular case, maybe you won't be able to get this or that capability because it'll be over here. What happens if that happens? And the admiral said, well, we can still do it. It'll just be more risk. And I thought, okay, well then what if this happens and you can't get access to this airbase or this ally doesn't, you know, all these things that are embedded in your plan, what if this doesn't happen? Well, we can still do it, ma'am, but it'll just be a little bit more risk. And I had this image in my head, you know, that Monty Python movie where they kept hacking the guy's arm off, you know, and he'd be like, just a flesh wound, you know. I just kept thinking, yeah, but like, I don't really understand what that means when you say risk. Does it mean we're gonna lose? Does it mean you're just gonna, like, it's gonna take longer? I mean, we're not very clear when we talk about what we mean when we say risk. And so there's risk embedded in war planning, and a lot of times it's about assumptions, or maybe in this case, the risk of optimism that you're gonna get everything that you need. War planners plan off of a menu. As Rumsfeld famously said, you go to war with the army or the military that you have, not the military that you wish you had. And that leads us to, how do you get that military? Usually that military is built like 10 or 20 years earlier. On assumptions that you're making, the kinds of things that Mac's talking about how dangerous the world is going to be, you know, what are the threats, and also what the nature of the conflict might be, how those threats might come at you, what kinds of wars you may have to fight. And then also we embed these things into our structure based on how we want to fight, which is often sort of optimistic as well. So all of this stuff is embedded into the force structure that we go to war with, to include our attitudes and our training, right? And so back to what it ends up looking like, this still doesn't really give you a sense of what risk is. And I'm thinking about in 2003, when we went to war with the military that we had in Afghanistan and shortly thereafter decided to pivot to Iraq. Now, you could say that was just a stupid idea, and a lot of people did say that it was, and some people even resigned because of it. But what that meant for risk was we basically swung assets, air cover, ISR, from an ongoing fight in Afghanistan, left guys in the mountains to get killed, and we lost bin Laden. That's risk. Like, that's what it looks like. So you get your head around that. The other thing about that, the military that I'm thinking, you know, the military that we went to war with in 2003 was supposed to be what they called the two major theater war strategy, right? We were supposed to have built a force that could simultaneously conduct two major theater wars. Now, at the time, Afghanistan didn't look like a major theater war. We only had a couple thousand troops on the ground, and even that, it turns out, we weren't able to accomplish. So our assumptions about what we needed for the two major theater war strategy were flawed. We couldn't even really do one and a half. And so that concerns me. So not only how we fight and the kind of fight we thought we were going to get into. The assumption was, some people would say, well, those are different kinds of wars, we didn't plan for this. But the assumption was that if you can do a big war, you can also do these other kinds of counterinsurgency things. We all know that not to be true now. But at the time, you see what happens. You build a force, and then you take it, you drive it on the freeway, and you realize it's kind of rickety and isn't going to work the way you wanted it to. So what does this mean for now? Where is the Pentagon heading now in the 2014? And I got to say, I think we are taking risk. I think that it's inevitable. You downsize after big wars, but then you also have to assess the future threat environment. We have budget constraints, and I would say that based on the constraints the Pentagon was given, they've done sort of an admirable job of threading this needle. They have adjusted the ends, the ways, and the means of their strategy looking forward in order to take these cuts. So let me just give you a couple of the highlights in order to get this something like $500 billion over 10 years. They're protecting modern technology, things that they think they might need for the peer fight, something like China. Cyber, missile defense, nuclear, space, ISR, air-sea battle things. They're also protecting counterterrorism assets. So what you see embedded in that is about a lot of assumptions about the way in which they think they will have to fight, the ways in which they will have to fight, which is more high-end. They feel like they haven't been investing in these technologies, and they need to rebalance to that. The other thing is, and this is one of the controversial ones, that second part where they want to rebalance towards counterterrorism. And people are talking about, oh, the Army, as Max said, is going from 590 or whatever all the way down to 420. Well, let's re-baseline here. From 2001, when the war started, the Army had 490,000 soldiers. It bumped up, and now it's bumping back down, because that's what we do when we have a war in America. We raise an army. So based on that, what you see isn't as much of a cut as you see a rebalance. We're at the end of the day, they're going to go to something like 450,000, but they may be lower, as Max says. So that's cutting about 40,000 soldiers. Meanwhile, the special operations community has gone from something like 33,000 in 2001 to when this budget kicks in, it'll be 70,000, right? So, and then the Marine Corps, based on 2001, was at 175,000, and it will end up at 184,000. So what you see is the Army going down, Special Ops and Marine Corps going up. Now, why is that? These are the assumptions they're building in. And this is where you unpack the nature of the risk, in my mind. There is an assumption that we can and we should avoid these big, long ground wars because nobody liked them anyway. My personal opinion is that's a pretty optimistic assumption. I don't know how necessarily much bigger we need. The other way in which you mitigate that kind of risk is through something they call reversibility. In America, we have the Guard and the Reserve Forces. And the idea is that you have a pretty well-trained, modern, high-tech military, but if you really have to go to war, you can leverage the Guard and the Reserve. That also is contingent on your ability to invest in the readiness of those. And so the degree to which they're doing that remains to be seen, and I think that we're probably taking some risk there. The other thing that's very controversial is instead of structuring for the two major theater war, they're basically structuring for one and a half. Okay, so they're saying, instead of being able to simultaneously execute two major theater wars, we're going to do one and be able to hold off an adversary in another theater. That's a lot of risk, actually, right there. And that's why they think that they can downsize in some of these ways. The other thing they're doing is they're changing the ways, right? So we already talked about soft forces, the way in which you fight. And they're trying to invest in preventing war. So there's a theory for you. If we can help build the partner capacity of lesser capable partners, then they can take care of the regional conflicts themselves. Well, I think even our NATO partners, who are supposed to be the best, are still struggling with that. And then there's another thing they're doing. And they're adjusting the concepts of operations of their war plans. So the ways, they're changing the way they fight. And they tell me that that will reduce risk. But it's classified, so I don't actually know. We can just hope. So when I look at overall risk, there's another, the big risk that's embedded in the Pentagon's budget is the risk that Congress won't play along. Because everything I just told you is their best case scenario, right? Their worst case scenario is that sequestration still kicks in. And they've painted a pretty grim picture of that for us. They say that if the cuts stay, they will greatly affect what the U.S. military can and cannot do over the next 10 years. The American people, that's you, would have to accept that the level of risk in conducting military operations would rise substantially, and then they paint a picture for you. Our military would be unbalanced and eventually too small to meet the needs of our strategy, which I've just described, leading to greater risk of longer wars and potentially higher casualties for the U.S. and for our allies and partners. Ultimately, continued resourcing at sequester levels would likely embolden our adversaries and undermine the confidence of our allies and partners and lead to a more challenging security environment than the one Max already described. So they're basically saying, over to you, Congress, to make sure all this bad stuff doesn't happen. So that's how I see the landscape. This is how I think the Pentagon sees it. It's where I think they're taking the risk. I think two things I think we might want to talk about in the discussion is the vision that they're painting for future conflict and whether or not we think that's realistic. I mean, while on the one hand, I do think that China as a rising power and developing military capabilities is something we need to be able to address. On the other hand, there is a question, a valid question about how much is enough, I mean, we do have the strongest, most capable, most high-tech military in the world. How much is enough? Which is that second order question of what is it that the American people want our military to do? What is it that the world wants us to do when it comes to Ukraine, when it comes to Syria? How much is enough?
Great. And so we've got, I think, a real conflict of opinion. I can see Max.
Taking notes.
Max is ready to come back. But first, I want to give Theo a chance. The British government, I think, has already done a lot of the downsizing, post-war downsizing that the United States is now contemplating. I'm asking Theo to give his opinions of that, and also perhaps to give us a British perspective of the American plans.
Hey, John, thanks. Actually, I prepared a whole bunch of comments on risk management in campaign planning, which I'm not going to talk about because John just asked me to speak about something else a few minutes ago. And so I've written a whole bunch of other comments. I'm going to pivot, that's right. But one point I did want to make is that I think risk management in campaign planning is very poor, actually, for a whole variety of reasons. But one of them, to echo Janine, is that it's just not very rigorous. Campaign planning is actually not very rigorous. And in particular, a lot of risk is simply assumed away. So most military plans start with assumptions. And in those assumptions, they'll simply assume away the risk that really is contained in the plan. And so, for instance, current ISAF campaign planning assumes away a lot of the risk around the political developments of what's happening in Afghanistan right now, and then gets on to the military stuff, which they're interested in. But it's all in the political space, actually. And so I think this is part of the problem. I mean, military plans are very large, they're very well developed, but actually they're not very rigorous. But we can talk about that. But turning to the British military, and you know, I've been hearing, obviously, Max and Janine speak about the problems that you guys have in America. Let me tell you, you don't have problems in comparison to our problems, right? The British military have a set of problems that are on a different scale from you, and not in terms of size, because obviously it's smaller, but in relative size, much larger. The fact of the matter is that defense is not that important to Britain. That's the bottom line here. National security, that's really important. So the stuff that David Oman was talking about, you know, his end of the business, that's really important. But the defense end, that's not really so important. So typically a British Secretary of State for Defense in the rank ordering of ministers of state will be number 8 or so. Yeah. During the Afghanistan war, for a long period, we had somebody who was both Secretary of State for Scotland and Secretary of State for Defense. He'd do 3 days a week on defense while we were in Iraq and Afghanistan, and 2 days a week on Scotland. And that gives you an idea of how the British government thinks about defense. It's very important. So, now actually, British defense spending has been ring-fenced. So it's going to basically stay at about £25 billion for the next few years. And that's pretty good, because if you look at Foreign Office spending, it's been vastly cut. And the context here is that the British government, the current government that came in, the coalition government, the Conservatives and the Liberals, inherited a massive national debt and very high levels of national of government deficit. And their key policy was to get a grip on the deficit, which they seem to have done successfully. So they're just cutting everything across the board. And in particular, professorial pay is really appalling in Britain. I just want to put that out there. Because we're funded through a government grant. So what you have in defense, part of the problem is $25 billion is actually quite a bit. You can do a lot with $25 billion, except Britain's in the process of acquiring moving from development to production in a number of very large equipment programs. You've got the Astute-class submarine, which is the new Hunter-Killer submarine. You've got the Future Carrier, which are going to come on stream around about 2020. Yeah. And the Elizabeth-class Future Carrier, which is our version of large deck carrier. You've got the F-35, which the Royal Air Force is committed to buying, which will fly off Royal Navy ships, because the Royal Fleet Air Arm probably won't have any money left to buy for the planes. And so these are all really, really expensive programs that put a huge strain on our defense budget. And then we've got Trident replacement, which the government's due to make a decision on. And critically, whereas previously Trident was placed outside the defense budget, which is something that defense was very happy about, the Treasury has insisted that it comes inside the defense budget. So these are real problems for us, right? And also, the problem this presents is in terms of force size. So you look at the Royal Navy and the Royal Air Force, its number of platforms. And the Royal Navy's basically just shrunk. The number of ships are quite important because it depends on how far, you know, your global presence. Well, the Royal Navy has shrunk massively. And likewise, Royal Air Force, the number of planes you've got. Chances are we won't have enough planes for two carriers. We'll have enough planes for one carrier. And so there's discussions about maybe flying French planes off the other carrier. I mean, this is the kind of nonsense, you know, the world we're in. So we're in a different, a whole different world of pain from you guys, right?
And
I want to talk about the British Army, because here the cuts are really profound. At the end of the Cold War, the British Army stood at 150,000 strong. It's currently at around about 100,000. On the current plan, Future Army 2020, the regular army will shrink to 82,000. I mean, you're really getting very, very small here. Now, built into this plan is this much more creative way of using the reserve forces. So what the army is going to increase the reserves from 18 to 30,000. It's called the Future Reserve. And when you combine that with your 82,000, you get an army which is supposed to be on paper about 110. So we're okay. The Future Reserve program was launched a year ago. A year in, we've increased the number of reserves from 17,000 to 18,000. They're not on track to build up to a future reserve of 30,000. And there are a number of reasons why. One is IT. So if you look at the history of British government programs, if it involves IT, it goes wrong. It's just, it's a golden rule, right? Any program involving IT in any sector of government goes wrong. This has gone wrong. So there's an interface problem with the defense IT system and the contractor IT system. But that's just technical stuff. It can be fixed. There's a bigger problem, which is a social problem underlying it. And this is, your relationship with your military is on a different scale from ours. I mean, I've always been struck walking around American airports where you see service personnel in uniforms. You don't tend to see that in Britain. And it's partly a legacy of the Northern Ireland business with the IRA terrorists. But it's also something different. You know, you walk around our main building, all the officers wear suits. They're not in uniform, right? It's different. Do you know that during the Iraq War, you would have situations where British soldiers would fly into Birmingham, and they'd be told to take off their uniform and put civilian clothes on before they walked into the terminal building so as not to upset locals in Birmingham Airport. I mean, it's staggering, right? And I've always been very struck and touched, and I think it's to your credit, where you get members of the public coming up and thanking people for their service. You do not get that in Britain. You just don't. So in that context, you know, when I look at what you ask from your National Guard and your reserves, go and serve in Iraq or Afghanistan for a year. And people do that, and they make that sacrifice, and their families make that sacrifice. It's from a point where their nation and country appreciate that service. Now, in Britain, the public opinion polls are really clear. There's strong levels of public support for the military, but being British and repressed, generally speaking, we just don't mention that, ever.
Right.
That's why Britain's a great place for stars. Film stars love to live in London, because no one will ever come up to a film star and say, oh, please, can I have your autograph, because we're all too repressed. But that has implications, right? Because for reserve units, for reservists and their families, why should they take off for 6-9 months? Will their employer give them release? These are things that are now being worked through. But it's really important because the Future Reserve Plan is really ambitious. The Future Reserve Plan is that currently what happens now is you will pluck individual reservists and shove them into what are regular units in Afghanistan to plug gaps. Right? The future plan is you'll pick up a whole reserve company. I mean, you guys will deploy a whole reserve battalion. We don't do that. The future plan is to pick up a whole reserve company and shove it into a mixed battle group. That's hugely ambitious for us, right? But that requires you to be able to call up the entire company rather than individuals. And currently, we're a million miles away from that. And that is really the problem, actually. And this is something I was testifying before our House of Commons about. It requires the Prime Minister to step up to the plate and to lead a national campaign to say, we need a new social contract with our military. And for whatever reason, the Prime Minister, it's so far down his list of priorities, he's not doing this. And so this is the problem. Our future army is predicated on, we will have two rapidly deployable brigades, the parachute, the 16 air assault, the parachute regiment, the Royal Marine Commandos, which are not army, of course, the Royal Navy, but for the purpose of this, and we will have three armored infantry. I guess there's five regular brigades. That is not enough to do Afghanistan again. Afghanistan requires brigade plus deployment, requires us to keep 5 or 6 brigades for every one we deploy. We couldn't do it. And currently, we couldn't do Iraq 2003. So the SDSR, Strategic Defense Review of 2010, said that we would deploy at best effort a division into the field, which is what we plugged into your led coalition in 91 and 2003. Currently, we could not do that again. So that's where we are.
So that's all very cheery. Let me increase the mood a little bit. I'm going to ask one more question, then turn to the members. Theo has spent a great deal of time in Afghanistan. Max is, and Janine has actually not been to Afghanistan. But I'm interested in the risk, the military risk that you see us taking as we approach the end of our combat mission in Afghanistan. And Max, I know you've got something to say about that.
Well, I think there's going to be a huge amount of risk depending on what kind of forces we leave in Afghanistan after 2014, because the military commanders on the ground, their judgment is that we need a minimum of 10,000 troops to support the Afghan security forces. And that, to me, is actually a bare-bones assessment, because I think the true figure is probably more like 20 or 30,000, but they've shaved it down to 10,000 to make it as politically palatable as possible, and even that may not be swallowed by this White House. I mean, I think to President Obama's credit, he did negotiate a bilateral security accord with Afghanistan, and now Karzai has flaked out of signing it. Hopefully, whoever his successor will in fact sign it. And if that were to happen, I hope that we will maintain support for Afghanistan at a level of at least 10,000 troops plus $4 to $5 billion a year in funding for the Afghan security forces. If we do that, I think there's a reasonable chance that Afghanistan will survive in more or less its current form. If we don't do that, I think it's going to be back to the 1990s with the Taliban once again on the march and a massive civil war breaking out. Now, John, if I can abuse your forbearance for a second and risk that caning that we talked about, if I could just throw out a couple of... I'm obsessed with caning here. If I could just throw out a couple of quick thoughts on what we just heard from Theo and Janine that I think tie into all this. I mean, what Theo is highlighting is the fact, let me underline this, our closest ally in the world is basically disarming. They are destroying their military. What that means is we are increasingly left alone to shoulder the burden of the defense of what used to be known as the West. If we don't do it, nobody else will. We cannot count on our allies because they are disarming much faster than we are. That makes it all the more imperative that we not follow their lead. Now, Janine presented what's going on not as a cut, but as a rebalancing back to 2001 levels. But as she herself noted, those 2001 levels were inadequate to deal with, not with two major wars, but with what the Pentagon would call two limited contingencies in Iraq and Afghanistan. We never had enough troops to handle those two wars at the same time. We barely had enough troops in either case. We had to really do the utmost and to strain the Marine Corps and the Army to the breaking point to gather up 170,000 troops to do the surge in Iraq. And the cost of doing that was we left Afghanistan undefended, which allowed the Taliban to come back in the post 2005-2006 period. And in Afghanistan, we surged up to 100,000. That still was not enough for the challenges that we faced. And a lot of it was just bad decisions made by the likes of Rumsfeld, Tommy Franks, and others. But they were also very constrained by the inadequate size of the army, even when it was at a wartime peak of 570,000, it was not adequate to deal with these two limited contingencies. How on earth would we have dealt with a real war against a real power, not the Taliban or Al-Qaeda in Iraq, but a real power with real weaponry? It boggles the mind. And now we're going back to a situation where we're not going back to 2001 levels, we're actually going below that. As Janine noted, the Army was at about 490,000 active duty and strength in 2001. We're probably going to wind up with an army of 420,000 within a decade. We're going to go down from 45 brigade combat teams to 24. That is not remotely adequate to deal with any conceivable scenario. And meanwhile, we're going to stress our Navy and Air Force to the breaking point, simply dealing with their peacetime commitments. The Navy is currently at 289 ships in the battle force. If sequestration is not repealed, we will probably be down to 250 ships within a decade. If you ask the combatant commanders around the world, their force requirements call for about 450 ships. There is no way we can possibly meet our commitments with the size force that we have today, but I don't see any inclination in Washington to cut the size of our commitments. In fact, we're finding new commitments all the time. We just sent 500 special operations soldiers to Uganda to hunt down Joseph Kony. When a hurricane hits the Philippines, everybody expects the U.S. military to respond. when Russia invades Ukraine, everybody expects the U.S. military to be there in Poland and the Baltic republics and those frontline states to assure our allies that we will protect them. In other words, I think what Washington really wants right now is for the U.S. military to do everything it's doing at the moment, but do it for 30% less. It's impossible. It doesn't add up. Something will break, and soon. This is a very, to me, dangerous and unacceptable level of risk that we are taking.
If only we could get Max to open up and tell us how he really feels. Let me highlight one point he made, which is that risk is not just to geopolitical accomplishment of objectives, but an awful lot of risk is borne on the backs of soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines. And we're going to be paying for generations for the price paid by the soldiers who were deployed over and over and over again for many years, many of them friends of mine. I'm going to give Jeanine and Theo a chance to answer and then go to the audience.
On the Afghanistan thing, I mean, I'm sorry, John, but I agree with Max that if we pull out precipitously and don't leave enough troops, things are going to spiral and it's not going to be pretty. And I think that this is an interesting... The American people are going to be very surprised by this, because I think we've gotten a sense, and I think you kind of express it with the way that the British view the world, is that these things are all very optional, and you know, if we hadn't started in the first place, it would all, so we can just rewind the clock and turn things back around. And I think that that's unrealistic. The American people right now are perceived to be very war weary, and they want everybody to come home on the one hand, but you know, Americans really don't like failing either. And when they watch what happens if we have a precipitous withdrawal, like they have been watching in Iraq, only even probably it could be bloodier and longer in Afghanistan. I think that we're going to see a different mindset. I mean, I would hope from the American people. I think that we quibble over numbers at our peril. Again, I don't necessarily think that the American people know the difference between 10,000 troops and 30,000 troops. The Pentagon knows the difference, and if they're saying that they need it to get the job done, it's not something they should probably quibble over necessarily, because what the American people notice, again, is failure. And so you've got to find that point on the curve where it's actually going to work. There's another big problem in Afghanistan, and that is we've failed to sort of articulate what it looks like to win. In fact, even using the word win is sort of problematic. I mean, it isn't just about vanquishing a foe. It's about getting an environment in a situation where the host nation can take over security. I mean, the Taliban's not going to go away overnight. Bad guys aren't going to go away overnight. So it's a trajectory towards transition, which is sort of really hard to explain to the American people. I'll just leave it right there. Let the members ask some questions.
Theo, Afghanistan.
So around the military risk, there's short-term military risk because the retrograde mission, which is the pulling the American army out of Afghanistan, is consuming a lot of capability, and that's capability that's not being committed to the ISAF mission. So there's a short-term risk around that, but actually I think the long-term military risk is very small. And if you look at the record of the Afghan security forces in the latest fighting season in 2013, they performed pretty well, actually. And the Taliban did not manage to take any... Basically, the Taliban have given up large-scale assaults. They've just... And there's very clear evidence of this. You know, we've done a lot of field research in Afghanistan actually on Taliban military tactics. And as of about 2010, there was a formal general order that came down from the credit assurer saying, give up large-scale assaults because you can't, you know, you're going to lose. So they haven't really got back into that game. So it's not like the situation with the Soviet pullout at all. It seems to me it's almost certain that the BSA will be signed after the election. NATO is basically right on the sofa, so they can just pull off the shelf, ready to go. I think a large-scale American military presence would not be helpful, is not desirable, actually. It's the presence of kafirs, of foreigners, in Afghanistan that is a major recruiting tool for the Taliban. So it's in our interest to draw down to the smallest force size we can, basically just to maintain strategic basing in Afghanistan for American usage in the region. Actually, that's why Afghanistan's interesting. What's really important is money. Actually, you just have to keep the money flowing. Just keep tipping money to Afghanistan would be fine, right? It doesn't really matter where it goes or what it does. It's true. I mean, 25% of the economy is corrupt, but it doesn't matter. That's the economy. That's how it works. So don't worry too much. Just keep tipping money in. Get your forces out. It's a much cheaper way of keeping the country going. Seriously. But in any case, it's not important. The military stuff is not so important. I spent a month last March in Afghanistan, and we interviewed tons of people about at, you know, looking forward to the future and transition and all this kind of stuff. We interviewed a whole bunch of people in Parliament who said, you know, we actually ended up asking them the question, between political transition and military transition, which is more important? The parliamentarian said, oh, political transition, of course. Okay, we expect that. Interviewed a bunch of generals and colonels in MOI and MOD, so asked them the same question, you know, this is after an hour-long conversation, because you can never have a short conversation in Afghanistan. And they all said, political transition. Everyone is looking at political transition. What is going to be the shape of a post-Karzai transition? That is the critical thing. And in fairness to ISAF planning, this thing it does recognize, the center of gravity is the confidence of the Afghan people in their future. And here, actually, I think there's a good news and bad news. So the good news is we're getting more clarity now on who are the lead candidates and how it's shaking down. And it looks like on the Pashtun side, it's going to be between Rasool and Ghani. Ashraf Ghani actually has managed to gather more support than anyone would have expected, I think. And he's now looking like a credible candidate. And obviously, Abdullah will probably get the most in the first round, but he'll be knocked out. And we'll probably see, it'll be, will Karzai continue to push Rasool, or will he finally string behind Ghani if Ashraf Ghani has enough support? So we're beginning to see how it looks like, which is really great, actually, for us. The bad news is fraud. There are 20 million voter registration cards. There are probably about 10 million legitimate votes in Afghanistan. You do the math, there's tons of fraud there. We saw it in 2009. And the other bit of bad news is there's nothing American can do about it. Just nothing, actually. Because any attempt to interfere in the elections will be a rerun of 2009. It'll be politically disastrous. And there's no willingness whatsoever for anyone on the ground to do anything about it. And I know that for a fact because I did all the interviews. You know, it's just too difficult, too much political risk. Just stand back.
The most risky thing I can imagine is making predictions about the Afghan elections. Ma'am, and we'll get a microphone in your hands. Please introduce yourself.
Betty Mushroom, Gear Holdings. It seems to me that the military should rethink what's important. We shouldn't be thinking about soldiers. We should be thinking about brains. Because soldiers fight another soldier, kill another soldier, but it doesn't change the decision makers. So if you put your money, it would seem to me in intelligence, training the Foreign Service better, making people smarter who are dealing with the decisions that commit all these soldiers, you would allocate more money to taking away ignorance and making decisions among world leaders, because war is really obsolete and the cost of soldiers is going to break the budget taking care of these people when they come home maimed, and nobody in any decision making is ever going to be hurt. So aren't we better counting brains rather than soldiers?
Janine, do you want to take that on?
The short answer is yes, of course. That's a better world to live in. The longer answer is I fear we don't live in that world yet. I don't necessarily know if our enemies think that way. And so I think you need to do both. I mean, I think, you know, maybe one day we'll get to the point where we really can solve our conflicts without the point of a gun. And we have when you look at major war statistics, we don't have those kinds of wars anymore. But we do still have a lot of bloody, messy, other kinds of things that when the stuff really hits the fan, people then say, you know, where's those soldiers to protect me? And so I think we're not quite there yet, but I do very much appreciate your vision that and hope that we get there.
I would just remind you of the old Roman maxim that if you want peace, prepare for war. And I think the greatest force for peace in the world in the last 60 years has been the United States military and our readiness to stand up to dictators and aggressors. And if we lose that, I think the prospects of war will become much more likely.
Sir.
Touche.
If our empire lasts as long as the Roman, we'll be in pretty good shape.
My name is Khalid Azim. I think Max makes the argument of the U.S. being essentially the indispensable nation argument. So why are we so indispensable? Why can't, you know, multilateral organizations like NATO, why can't we force others to pony up more? Why do we have to do it? Why can't we use the world who are allies to support us?
Theo, why don't you guys step up, man?
Theo, lay it on us.
Theo, we're counting on you.
What up?
Well, there's a few reasons. The first reason is that the Europeans don't have to because you do it. It's true, though.
It is true.
The second reason is, though, that you have the Americans, this is fairly obvious, have more of a sense of that you want to do things in the world that the Europeans just don't want to do. Yeah. So quite a lot of European action is actually just to keep you guys happy. A lot of European involvement in...
Ukraine is the backyard of Europe. Bosnia, you know, yeah, was the backyard of Europe.
Sure.
So why isn't Europe, you know, at the lead in dealing with...
So there's obviously great variation within European views. If you actually look at the German view towards Ukraine, what's happening there, they're much more sympathetic to Russia's reasons why Russia is engaged in the behavior it does. So within Europe, there's very considerable division of opinion on a lot of these things. It's what you have to appreciate. But the one thing that is common to all European countries is defense is not that important. That's the one thing that's common. But beyond that, there's difference of opinions in almost any area of foreign policy. So the first thing to realize is Europe is not really a unitary actor. So it will never be the case that Europe should do this in place of America. It'll be individual European countries prepared to do stuff to support an American initiative. But when America doesn't lead, Europe doesn't do. It's as simple as that. And the North Atlantic Council is a very good example as to why. 28 members in the NAC means the NAC can't do strategy. So if you look at what happened in Afghanistan, basically, Afghanistan was left to NATO to deal with in 2003 onwards, and NATO just did nothing with it, right? It took the Obama administration to re-engage and develop a strategy and then push that strategy. But up to then, we didn't actually have a strategy. The NAC didn't produce a credible strategy, and there was no push for the ISAF HQ to push a strategy. So you're a big, powerful, unitary actor. That's why you can act strategically. Europe is a bunch of smaller actors that don't really care about defense, argue among each other about almost everything, disagree on what to do in the world. And so they'll never do anything until you do something, and then a bunch of them, some of them will support you, and others won't, but they'll come along anyway because it's easier to do that than not to do it.
Can I just add one thing to what Theo just said? I mean, Theo is right, but there is also a structural impediment to defense spending in Europe, which is that in most of these European states, the government consumes around 50% of GDP, and they support massive social welfare states. There is simply no room left over for defense spending, because if they try to cut social welfare spending, they will literally have riots in the streets, and so they just are not going to do it. That's why the members of NATO are spending less than 2% of GDP on average on defense. So we can hope and wish and demand that the Europeans do more on defense, but it's not going to happen, as every single Secretary of Defense who has delivered this message for the last 40 years has found out.
A risk we're not willing to take. In the back, sir.
Galen Gingrich, having been with Max in Afghanistan last spring, let me just say that I agree completely with his assessment of Afghanistan. If the U.S. is at best rebalancing and our allies are downsizing or disarming, would you say a bit about the rest of the world, our current or potential adversaries? Obviously, China's investing. What's going on with military readiness in the rest of the world?
Janine?
Well, I mean, I think that this is one of the key points of the Obama administration to say, a lot of Europeans think, oh, the United States is pivoting, which was never the word that we wanted to use, rebalancing to Asia, away from Europe. Well, that wasn't actually the point at all. And you don't see actual brigades leaving Europe and going to Asia. What you see was a sense that we've been really busy in Iraq and Afghanistan and nearly obsessed with the so-called global war on terror. And while we've been doing that for the last 10 years, things have been happening in the world. The only place in the world where defense spending is rising is Asia. And it's not just China. It's the other countries across Asia who are sort of worried about the stability in the region. And they were expressing to the Americans, you know, are you guys still with us out here? Are you still part of this? Are you going to still be, you know, the security guarantor of the region? And so that was the impetus for the rebalance. It was, and people under, and I think Richard Haass pointed this out yesterday, a lot of leadership is just showing up. And so just being there, the diplomatic pieces, the economic pieces, and I would not downplay the, people like to say that there's no military part to the Asia rebalance. This is not true. I mean, there was a movement afoot to bring troops home from Korea. We forget this. The Obama administration said, no, enough is enough. We're staying. And all these Marines that had been deploying from Okinawa into Iraq and Afghanistan, they're going back. And so rebalance meant rebalance. It didn't mean just shift everything over to Asia, right? And so I think that's important. Now, I'm sure Max has a lot to say about this as well, but the big challenge here is you can have a long-term strategy And we do, and you can continue to push towards it, but you will be distracted by other things in the world, right? And so the question will be whether we can walk and chew gum at the same time. People think we aren't going to have enough assets to do both. But when you think about the massive resources that we have been expending or had been expending in Iraq and Afghanistan, one day those will be less. And where will they be?
I mean, I think Galen asked a very important question, which is what our adversaries are doing. And if you look, as I mentioned before, if you look at China, they are growing their defense budget by double-digit amounts every year, 12% increase this year. In Russia, Putin is spending over 4% of GDP on defense, and he's actually, I think, done a pretty good job of reforming the Russian military, which was pretty defunct after the end of the Cold War. But now if you look at what's actually happened in Crimea, they are acting pretty professionally. They know what they're doing. They're disciplined, they're focused, they're achieving their objectives. They are a formidable adversary. Iran is not so much a conventional military threat, but obviously they're spending an awful lot of money on their nuclear program. And the other element that I would mention, which is not a conventional nation-state adversary, but an adversary we have to worry about, which is al-Qaeda and other jihadist groups who are currently in control of a significant chunk of northern and eastern Syria and western Iraq. And they don't require vast amounts of conventional military expenditures. All they need is money for AK-47s and explosives and a few other low-end items, but they can nevertheless cause tremendous damage. And that's a huge threat that doesn't show up on the rankings of conventional military spending.
Anatole?
Thank you. Anatole Levin, King's College. A point and a question to anyone who would like to answer. In the 1960s, America and Britain, in its much smaller way, had, of course, immensely larger armed forces than we do now. America had the draft, so that generated it. Britain, nonetheless, chose to keep out of Vietnam. That, I think, is generally seen these days to have been a wise decision, because America did choose to fight in Vietnam, and it did not turn out very well, and had obviously wider impacts on American prestige. So what I'm asking is concerning Ukraine. Supposing we had much, much bigger armed forces than we have now, I mean, as big as one can conceivably imagine them, would we fight in Ukraine? Should we fight in Ukraine? Could we fight in Ukraine, given the attitudes and the will of our populations, both here and in Europe? In other words, the size of your armed forces does not absolve you of the decision where to fight and how to judge both your interests and the situation on the ground.
Jeanine?
I mean, I think Putin's doing a fine job of throwing in a bunch of, you know, irregular masked special operations guys that he can pretend like don't work for him, and take over Crimea and threaten to move further into eastern Ukraine, or even all the way into Ukraine. Can we, America, stand up to that? Absolutely, we can. Do we need to, or if a push come to shove, could we? Yes, of course. I'll let Theo speak for the UK, but I don't think that the conventional threat coming from the Russian forces is so big that we need to completely, you know, gin up a draft or something in the United States. What I think we can do, actually, is I think we can assist the Ukrainian forces with, even without putting American boots on the ground, to raise the level of uncertainty in Putin's head, right? I mean, what's the worst thing that can happen to him right now? I mean, he's on a high. He's focused on reestablishing Russian pride. The worst thing is the risk that he's going to fail militarily against some sort of force that he encounters if he moves further into Ukraine. Right now, that force is just the Ukrainian military. They don't look so bad, sort of free for the taking. If, however, there was a sense that those forces were at least supported by NATO, such as it is, in the United States, air power, intelligence, MREs, and weapons, I think that would be what we would call deterrence by denial. The idea that he would be denied victory would be too humiliating for him to try right now. Because he knows that if it actually did come to all-out war, he wouldn't succeed.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting this. I think the issue here that you raised, which is very interesting. I think the problem is not tactical, it's strategic. So, and this is where I would disagree with Max. I mean, America wants to fight a war against another state. You know, that's the kind of war you want to fight, okay? Because if other states didn't learn the lesson in 91, they sure as hell learned in 2003. If you're a state and you put your army in the field against the American army, just kiss it goodbye. That's a crazy thing to do. The problem is not tactical, it's strategic. The problem with fighting another state, which is if that state is integrated in the international system, the strategic ramifications of war against that state are massive, especially a state as important as Russia. So the reason why Iraq was a great state to fight a war against was because you'd managed to marginalize it so well beforehand. Yeah, so that seems to me the issue. It's not tactical. You can easily take another state out in military competition. America can easily do that. It's strategic. Now, in Britain's case, Britain would never join a war on this for the foreseeable future. I take John's point to heart, by the way. You should never make predictions, because if you've read that very good book about making predictions, you realize it's a very poor practice. But that said, and accepting that states can't always choose the wars they fight, Britain is suffering from the shadow of Iraq. I mean, Iraq was politically a disaster for the Blair administration. And any prime minister now in Britain for the foreseeable future will realize that you undertake a war at your peril, okay? I mean, it's an incredibly risky thing to do. And just in case you didn't get the message enough, when Cameron tried to put a vote to the Commons on using force in Syria in support of what was then, America was beefing up to, you know, possibly take military action against Syria over chemical weapons, and then the French President Hollande said, okay, we'll definitely do that, and then of course you guys said, oh, actually, we changed our mind. That was a bit embarrassing for the French, so that'll change their calculations in the future. But the British government tried to get a vote in the Commons, and they pulled a vote when they realized they weren't going to get the votes. And this is because parliamentarians now don't really, they're much more cautious about trusting the government and what the government says on the necessity to use force. So the political calculations in Britain around using force in support of a future war are much more cautious and complex now. And that's why you don't expect that America will, that Britain will turn up as it did in Iraq and Afghanistan. We could be well dealing with the future of Vietnam where the Brits go, actually.
Just fast footnote to underline what Theo just mentioned about Syria. I think Anatole raises a good point, which is that it's not just having military capabilities, it's also having credibility and having credibility in international affairs. And I think we have done grave damage to our credibility by drawing a red line in Syria and then allowing Assad to cross it with impunity. That is, we also did grave damage by allowing Putin, by the way, and this was a previous administration, to take a good chunk of Georgia and basically suffer no repercussions. Now he's taken Crimea without massive repercussions, some repercussions, not massive. Again, I think this is damaging our credibility, and it's making it very hard to dissuade either Putin or other aggressors in the future from similar actions.
Last question from Mr. Solomon, and then I'm going to give each of you one quick chance to answer, to sum up this scintillating conversation.
I want to suggest a somewhat different approach to security planning from what I'm hearing. We're replaying a classic American pattern where we lose public support for sustaining a substantial military presence. We pull back, and then we get whacked, whether it's a Pearl Harbor or 9/11. Then we remobilize and fight it at higher cost, and presumably you come out of it all right. What worries me about the current situation is if you replay that scenario, some of the threats that we face may not give us the opportunity to remobilize and rebuild defenses. I mean, I could think of, in an era of suicide bombing, a WMD type of attack, whether it's nuclear or bio, a cyber attack that shuts down our electrical grid. In other words, the nature of warfare is changing, and are we thinking ahead and planning for a scenario of the sort that I've described where, again, our risks are higher, we get hit, and we may not be prepared to remobilize and deal with a new kind of threat?
Highest risk option. And we'll run the table and then close.
I think that's a very wise and perceptive question. And I think even if we did not face this new world, which we do, I think, with suicide bombers and WMD threats, even in the old world, this was a stupid pattern. We would demobilize way too much, and then we would not be ready for the next conflict that came along. And the price was paid by our troops in uniform sent out there at Kazarine Pass or you know, Task Force Smith in Korea or wherever to get slaughtered because they were not ready for the combat that they actually had to face. Now, as a historian, I would hope that we would have some capacity to learn from history, and yet we seem to keep repeating these same mistakes. And as you underline, it's even more foolish to do it now because this is not just a distant threat that we face halfway around the world where we're going to have time to mobilize and rearm and retrain and all this kind of stuff. We can face a threat right here with no warning and be in the midst of a massive conflict that nobody anticipated. I mean, who on September 10th of 2001 imagined we would be fighting in Afghanistan? And who can predict in the future with great confidence we will face no more major wars, no more ground wars? All these assumptions which are embodied in the current defense drawdown are crazy. They're ahistorical, and they are extremely dangerous.
Janine.
Well, I mean, I think it's a strategy of hope is what Max is talking about. We do have this pattern. I think the risk we have right now is that, yeah, the American people are war weary, but we launched on what Richard Haass calls these wars of choice, right? And so we think that wars are all of choice. And so we have the sense that, you know, well, we shouldn't have done that, we shouldn't have done this, so let's not do it again. Like we have a choice, right? Like we can just say, well, we just won't do that. And I think that's a dangerous sort of the mood music that we're dealing with right now that is influencing a lot of our strategic thinking. And I think it will be dangerous. Also, it's about the kinds of nature of conflict. So if we get past that and we think, okay, well, we still do have to think about what the threats are. And some of the things that you mentioned, I think, are really important. And I don't think we're necessarily thinking about these things in an out-of-the-box sort of way. When you think about, you know, a Mumbai-style attack on New York City or, you know, Tampa or chemical or these kinds of things, these are things that ride at the intersection between homeland security and national security. And if Ray Kelly were here, he'd say, oh yeah, New York City's got all kinds of plans for this sort of thing. I think we need to get our heads around those sorts of resilience oriented threats and the ways in which we think about conflict in the future. It needs to be a lot more creative, but that's once you get over the hurdle that you can just avoid it if you decide to.
Yeah.
I think I'll differ with my panelists actually on this, which is that I think demobilization makes sense. When you're finished a war, you demobilize. I mean, it's a pattern in history. There's questions around pace and scale, and that's where it seems to me there has to be a discussion. And there's questions around force regeneration and reserves and how you prepare reserves for future regeneration. But across history, when wars are over, you demobilize. And in this sense, the Cold War was a proper Cold War. It was a war of necessity, right, against the Soviets. It maintained a vast, huge army. The Brits did, the Americans did. That war was over. It made sense to demobilize afterwards. And likewise, now when these wars are over, you should demobilize to invest national resources elsewhere. But where I think I don't like the distinction between wars of choice and wars of necessity. And I'd rather think that there are some wars that are just manifestly and obviously necessary because the enemy, the barbarians on your doorstep. But otherwise, I think mostly they're wars of discretion, where the degree of necessity is a political judgment you make, actually. Mm. And then when you make that judgment, if it's necessary, you mobilize. And I understand there are questions around where more complex weapon systems we're dealing with now, more complex ways of fighting, but you can prepare for that with reserve forces. It just makes sense to me that you do mobilize, but discuss the pace and scale.
There were many risks on this panel, but there was no risk that with these three, this would be boring. I'd ask you to join me in thanking them.